Yeah, hello everybody, and it's really a great honor for me to be here today with you and discuss these very important topics, and I hope many other situations like these will follow and we have more discussion on this, because I think this is really an uprising topic. I will now support your endeavors with some psychological reasoning, and I will start with a little psychological trick that you all know. It's the proverbial tie in the handkerchief. Oh, you could just simply name it a little reminder. It's this slide, because actually I always tend to forget to introduce myself. As Ney mentioned, my name is Jan-David Freund. I studied and did my doctorate in developmental psychology and early childhood education. And since this year, I work for HABA in the games development department, and my task there is to manage and advance and extend the HABA learning program, and also to hold up the interests of game-based learning. So perfectly fitting to our today's topic. And this in every step of product development, and I try to give them all my expertise in consulting to improve these processes. And my aim for today is to provide you with some good science-based reasons that you can use so to bring board games in education contexts. So these reasons hopefully will enable you to convince everyone in charge to grant you the resources for more game-based educational activities. Okay, here we go. Actually, there are many more good reasons for game-based learning, but more than I've listed here, and far too much for 25 minutes. So we have to focus a bit. And therefore, I will focus on these first three reasons and then briefly mention the second three, and the last two are perhaps something for discussion or for questions afterwards. So let's dive right into the first reason. Good games bring fun into learning. Sounds good, doesn't it? Well, this is the approach of the so-called educational games, or in German we call them Lernspiele. And the principal idea is actually quite appealing. You have a learning situation, and it's a bit more fun and motivating than other learning situations, and you use means of playing to reach that goal. However, I would advise to switch priorities here and use games that focus on fun and joy instead of learning. And I admit that this might sound a bit provoking, because in education context, it is accepted to have some fun, but have a focus on fun. Yeah, not everybody will be in line with this. Or in other words, how will I convince my head teachers and the parents of this idea? And this is the reason for my psychological reasoning. So here's the task for you. Imagine you have 1 hour to learn something that you want to remember, not just for a few hours, but for as long as possible. How would you spend your time? You don't have to raise your hands, just think about it. What kind of learning do you think is most efficient in the long run? Yeah, you might have some good idea in mind, because there are a lot of teachers here in the room, but the most popular learning technique in the world is rehearsal. Just repeat the contents over and over again. At least you have 1 hour, quite a lot of time, and then you can be sure that you will remember some of the contents you wanted to learn. And you end up quite exhausted. But okay, the task was not to enjoy yourself, the task was to learn something. So, but now let's pass some time. And what we see here is called the forgetting curve, or Ebbinghaus'sche Kurve, named after a German psychologist of the late 19th century. And in his experiments with nonsensical words, he came to the very disappointing result that not even 1 out of 4 bits of information sticks for more than 6 days learned by rehearsal. And these results, of course, 100 years is a lot of time, science developed much further, but these results seem to hold even now. So, what do you think? Can we do better? Well, of course. So, here's kind of another task. I want to ask you, which memory is more vivid in your, in your head? What were your working tasks at your very first day at your current job? Think about that. Can you remember something, all of it? It might be a long time ago, the very first day you were on your current job. You might have some idea in your head, and now think about what were your working tasks at the second day after this year's New Year holidays? Not the first day, the second day. Okay, the first task sounded hard, but even I can't remember what I did on the second day after the New Year's holidays, and I came up with these questions. So it's really hard to think about the second question. Perhaps you had some special event, some special effects, or perhaps your first day at work was very boring, but even then you might remember it. So what is the difference between these two situations? It's the intensity of your emotional engagement. The more intense your emotions are in the moment, the more vivid are your memories of that moment later on. And if this didn't work for you, you might just have a very relaxed first day with not very much strong emotions and you were very calm. This is good for you, bad for my example, but I think you get the idea. So, considering this, let's compare our peer rehearsal with learning situations with some time reserved for emotional engagement. Okay, the time spent on emotional engagement might come at a cost, and the initial efficiency of our learnings falls a little bit off compared to peer rehearsal. But, as my example illustrated, on the long run, emotionally engaged learning is clearly more efficient than peer rehearsal. And this is because memorizing and emotions are very closely linked in the human brain. So, we need strong emotions, right? How about anger? Strong emotion. Or fear, also strong emotion. Who of you believes that these emotions will help us learning? Yeah, I guess so. So, of course, this is rubbish. We don't need those emotions. While negative emotions block our openness to new information, positive emotions... But you will remember those things, but you cannot learn on based on those things, those emotions. You need positive emotions to learn. So how about joy and excitement, for example? So joy and excitement, learning with joy and excitement is the most efficient. You can clearly say that from science. But joy and excitement, how to get to them? Yeah, these are very characteristic, of course, for playing games. So learning with board games here is the best one in lines with the graphs. And when making games, at least for Hub, I can report that always the focus should be, and for us, I can say it is, to make the games tailored to the needs of children, especially for their age, and have them experience joy and excitement when playing the games. This is, at our company, and should always be the main focus. And this is what I'm saying with put a bit of learning into a lot of fun. So focus on the fun, really. And why is this? Or better, first to start, how to do this? How to do this? This can range over long, because the process of making a game is so long, it starts from deciding which games to make. So have some pretests, compare how are children reacting to this game idea or that game idea. Then how to change the rules. Perhaps there's some unnecessary frustration. They always, instead of getting something, they're destroying something from the other players. So why frustrating them? It's not necessary. The game is great with a little benefit instead of some kind of penalty for someone else. Or it's up to things like the illustrations. You can ask the illustrator, oh, this is really an adventure game and it's made for 6-year-old. The illustrations are quite calm. Could we have something more adventurous so that the children really enjoy and feel the adventure so the emotions really rise? Or in other situations, can you make it more light colors for younger children so it really fits to the children and they have the chance to enjoy the game? And if you're interested in the neural backgrounds of this, these effects, I recommend to search for a brain component called the amygdala. So if you're searching this, learning and amygdala, you'll find a lot of good research, or you could just search for the role of emotions in human memory. So there's really a lot of research on this. So we have the positive emotions helping us to remember the things we learned while playing, but there's of course more than that. Yeah, this looks... Okay, you like math. I heard you like math, so this might not cause some anxieties to you, but it looks quite abstract, doesn't it? So it's also a bit boring, perhaps, or confusing, and it really is largely detached from children's real life. So these formulas might have some impact, but the children can't see the impact. The children don't understand why the formulas are in the real world. This is a good reason because experts need those kinds of communication to get together with each other. They need a clear kind of communication, very exact, in a precise manner, to avoid any misunderstandings in the field. However, for novices and especially for children, these abstract forms of representation can be a huge barrier to learn, even with the help of positive emotions. I have an example for this. At some point, at least in Germany, children have to learn the multiplication rows of all single-digit numbers, later on even the two-digit numbers, but the single-digit numbers is something here in Germany is quite typical for elementary schools. Or maybe some teacher could tell me that this has changed, but it has been so for a very long time. So, quantities and numbers are very abstract for children in elementary school. And when they start dealing with these concepts, the result might be that they do not really understand what they are learning. For children, these multiplication rows are just a collection of phrases, like the lines of a very boring poem. And with this motivation, and with a lot of motivation, endurance, and perhaps the help of some positive emotions, they will successfully learn this by heart. And then they know how to complete the line, 6 times 7 is, and you know it in your head. Or they will know how to continue the sequence, 7, 14, 21, 28, 35, and your head always, okay, now what's next? Or they may even have a graphical representation of the sequence and know how the number, which number stands here in this row between 35 and 49, because they learned it this way. But I really think this is not what is meant by true understanding or what is in line with the educational aims of math classes. At least I don't think so. And I think you will agree, I would advise to help the children really develop a manifest mental representation of numbers and to really understand the relation of numbers with each other. And this is exactly the approach children use intuitively. And I bet there's no one here who hasn't witnessed this sometime before. Because, yeah, fingers. Fingers are a direct manifestation of numbers. And until recently, children have been prohibited to use these, their fingers in counting, at least in school, because some thought that this might prohibit the learning. But today we know that this prohibiting this slows the development of a good understanding of mathematical concepts, and especially for number representation. So finger counting supports the learning process because it visualizes how numbers, digits, and quantities and real-world objects are associated. And it also helps to develop a foundation for the later understanding of real abstract mathematics. And this association is really with real-world objects, with numbers, digits, quantities, is exactly what happens in many games. And of course, this is nothing exclusive to games, but it can easily be regarded as one of the defining characteristics of games. And the better children get at connecting all the mathematical concepts, the better they will master typical challenges in games. The integration of mathematical concepts can happen very subtly, like in the game To Market, you're on the left side, and the girl is counting numbers of coins. So she has to give away some coins to pay the items she bought on the market. And at the same time, she recognizes how many coins she has left after subtracting this quantity. This is happening at an age where the child would never think about subtracting any numbers. But here's something that she will experience while having fun. It's the right context, it's doing the right thing at the right age, preparing all that comes later. And in other games, like here on the right, the handling of mathematical associations is much more explicit. For example, here on the game, Clever Bear learns to count. Fingers, dice pips, numbers of objects, and digits have to be matched and translated from one form to the other. Okay, I have to admit something. The Clever Bear is labeled as an educational game, and I told you I have educational games, but I have nothing against educational games. I think the learning fun is the most important thing. It can be labeled as an educational game. I have nothing against this. It should be based on the fun. So you can see it on the blue wave saying that this is a learning game. However, the game is focused on fun, so everything is fine. The children will enjoy themselves while playing. Games such as these two create opportunities to apply the skills already acquired and incentives the children to deepen and expand these competencies. And this is not only less boring than the abstract training of skills, but also acts as a bridge between abstract knowledge and everyday applications, because many games are based on everyday tasks and break them down to a level understandable to children. So, games are great to connect abstract knowledge with touchable reality. This helps children to understand the world. And what we understand, we can deduce instead of learning by heart. So we don't have to learn by heart all those poem lines, but we will come up with a solution because we understood the concept. But learning by heart has its advantages as well, of course. You can save a lot of time if you know things by heart, which you need frequently. Sometimes it is even unavoidable to learn something by heart. This is especially the case when it comes, for example, to languages and labels, because they are quite arbitrary set. For example, the cardinal directions. Who decides? How to deduce this? Or clearly defined orders, for example, the letters in the alphabet. or sequences of numbers, for example, your most relevant telephone number. It's good to have these things learned by heart, so you will come up without deducing something. Or does anyone have an idea how to quickly deduce some of these facts? So learning by heart is nothing really bad. We have to have this as well, not for this abstract concepts, but for other purposes. So wouldn't it be great if games fostered learning by heart as well? Yeah, of course. And of course they do. Many games require memorizing a sequence of words, pictures, symbols, and if they are well done, they also will teach you the technique to make it easier. Or at least they will propose a technique. They will make it easy to apply a technique. They are made for a technique. And one example is, you might all know the game I Took a Trip, or in German it's called Ich packe meinen Koffer. And here you have a list of items, and this list of items, in each turn, the list will expand by one item. So I start with the green flippers, then you have the green flippers and the red shirt, the green flippers, the red shirt and the ballet shoes, and so on, so on. The list grows with each turn. And you can either leave it up to the children to figure out how to memorize the list, or you can use the opportunity to explain a powerful learning technique to them. And this was the way how I learned the game when I was a child. This is the reason why I took this example here. So, for example, this could be a story like this. And this technique is called the mnemonic link system, or chain method, or the topical mnemonic. Mnemonics are always these learning or memory techniques. And for this technique, we need a story that leads us from one object to the next. So, for example, on the first day of our holiday, I will go to the sea, so I will have to bring my flippers. And to avoid sunburn, I will wear my red shirt. This is far better than wearing a ballet shoes or a wooden cap. In the evening, I will write everything into my secret diary, and so on and so on. And stories like these work like a string. They connect the individual facts so that you find your way from one information to the next, because these stories provide a meaningful context, and meaningful contexts are always easier to learn. And this is not only very efficient or effective, but also exactly the principle that comes into play when learning through games. Because most games tell an appealing story. At least they should. So at least our games do. For example, in Off to Bed, children learn to connect the sequence of steps of going to bed, and they are connected to a story. So the children, after playing this game for one or two times, they will know what's missing if they're going to bed without brushing their teeth, because they know there's one step in between. I know this from the game. And this even works for children at the age of two. So it's really impressive. And of course, there are games that bring this to older ages as well. So to sum this all up, learn through play should bring a bit of learning into a lot of game, play, fun, and joy. And this might not fit into every learning context, and it might reduce the sheer amount of learned content, but it will definitely boost the lasting effect of the learning. Or to say it with the famous Swiss pedagogue Johann Heinrich Pestalozzi, the holistic learning is learning by head. We had the incorporated learning techniques. By hand, we had the connection of abstract knowledge with physical objects, and by heart. And actually, in Pestalozzi's notion, this was about moral, discipline, and faith, but that was 200 years ago. Today, it's rather understood as emotions and learning things by heart, in the sense of you have all your guts with it. You are totally engaged. So we have the emotional engagement perfectly. We have all the heart, the hand, and the head. So, and this actually was my main message. I said you the first three reasons I want to focus on that. And I hope this alone was already quite helpful for you to convince head teachers, parents, colleagues to assign more resources, and this is basically the core problem, to game-based learning. But of course, there are further important reasons, and I want to mention at least two more of them very briefly. And here in this part, we will actually have some overlapping with the talk before, which really was very good and had some of the very good arguments I'm using here as well. But I think rehearsal is nothing bad. We can have some rehearsal here as well. So the first of them is motivation. Children are naturally curious, right? So what do you say? Children are so curious that you could easily, they will hang on your lips if you read them from a dictionary, right? Because they're so curious, and there's so much information in that, and they will love all the information. It's about the world, and they can understand things. Yeah, okay. Perhaps for a minute, or perhaps five, if you promise them some kind of reward, then they will hang on your lips. But nah, that's not how it works. This is not very persevering. But what about playing? Children can play for hours. They can play for hours without a reward, without a break. And this is not because playing is so easy. Sometimes it even appears to us adults that it's quite exhausting, or it even is monotonous. And they love it anyway, and this is no coincidence. We had it before, but it's really a good thing. No other creature has built its evolutionary success so much on the active transfer of knowledge and skills from one generation to the next as humans. Human civilizations would fall apart. The culture would fall apart if we would not transfer our knowledge from one generation to the next. So we really need to depend on this. We cannot develop all knowledge from scratch with each new generation. And for humans and animals alike, playing is the main path of active knowledge transfer. This has been so long time ago, and it's so as well today. And like other evolutionary relevant behaviors, playing is connected with endocrine and neural reward systems. Or in simple words, learning through play is fun in a way that you cannot evade. It's simple. You can compare it like for eating. Nobody has to reward you for eating because it's connected in your brain. You want to eat because it's, and yeah, you will enjoy it and you have a good feeling afterwards. And it's actually the same with learning. And it's part of our biology. And activities we enjoy in such a way we want to do again and again without anyone else pushing through rewards or penalties. And this is called intrinsic motivation. And there's no more efficient way to get children to learn persevering and focused. Children want to play games again and again. They motivate children to rehearse their contents again and again. So if the games are motivating, children will do their contents without external reward from their own again and again. What a great situation, what a great chance to use. And this with the right emotions. So it truly has best of both worlds. And games are actually so motivating that children even love to do logopedic exercises again and again. And you would tell those children, you have to do those exercises for your mouth muscles, and here you have something to play. This is not fun. They won't do it. It's, oh, do I have to do it today as well? Can't I make a break day and continue tomorrow? But if you have a game, they will enjoy it and will do this for hours and they want to do it again and again. And this is actually the background of some of the games. For example, here the boy on the right, he's puffing. It's something important. You have to put your muscles in your mouth in a very specific way, and you need this for proper pronunciation. And some children need some extra effort on learning this to train their muscles. And if you have the same, they are doing this from their own. So great chance. So even fans of classic rehearsal, games are educational medium of choice as well. And then finally, I want to point out, besides being an excellent medium for educational contexts, games also foster a set of other very important abilities. And we had this also before in the talk before, because these are really those abilities that are thought to be key for academic success, success and beyond that, even life success and life satisfaction in modern day societies. The problem is, these are very specific competencies, and the time to foster these competencies is always too short. There's always too few resources in school. You can't really train them at this place because you have so many other things to train there. And of course, I talk about social and emotional skills, and I will start with those abilities which can be subsumed under the term self-regulation, or we had it, the executive functions. It's really a similar concept. It's hard to tear them both apart, and I won't go into this detail now. But self-regulation is really a key competence for life success in all modern societies. And it includes skills like focus, perseverance. These are needed to stick with one task. Inhibition. We had the response inhibition, but there's also the kind of inhibition that you need to block out disturbances from inside or outside. So perhaps you're hungry, but you have to concentrate on this task. You have to inhibit the feeling of hunger. Or there's someone sitting next to you who has a strange smell or talking all the time. You have to inhibit this and focus on your task. And for this, you need inhibition, like willpower, you could say. Then you have cognitive flexibility. This is needed to quickly deal with new requirements. Okay, you're writing something, there's a phone call. Ah, okay, I have to think about the phone call, then come back to my document. And this happens all the time, in each working day, of course. And so you need this task, or even some scientists even say there is no such thing as multitasking in this sense of doing things in parallel, but instead you're always switching between the tasks very quickly. And those who are better at multitasking are better at switching between the tasks. And those who are slower seem to not be able to multitask, but you really cannot focus 100% on two tasks in the same time, but you can switch very quickly. So very good to be cognitive flexible. And of course, frustration tolerance. And we need this to deal constructively with setbacks. And setbacks are everywhere in life. And we have to go on. So if we miss a train, we can't stand on the track and cry, but we have to think about, okay, how will I get there now? What is the best solution? Wait for the next train, take the bus. What is the solution? Don't cry at the track. And game challenge and stimulate all these skills. We have it on the right side. And especially if the games are well suited to the age, this is very important. The game situation is well structured, so it might not be the best solution to just throw the games in the classroom and walk away, because then the children will focus in many aspects, but not so much about on these self-regulation skills. You have to have an eye on it and sometimes perhaps help to help with frustration or to prevent some kind of basking in their victory and making all the other children angry. So it needs some kind of support. And it's like self-regulation is something always should be supported by adults, because children start to learn self-regulation as something external. They cannot, a little baby cannot self-regulate it himself or herself. They need to learn this from external, and then they internalize this, and later on they can do it on their own. And it's really a matter of perspective to see all these things in games, like sticking to rules, taking turns, coping with losing. And they can be regarded a great training program for all these skills. And the same goes for other important social and emotional skills. Co-op and team games train the ability to cooperate and form a team spirit, as well as to get along with others, including outsiders, and also shy or difficult children. Daring, courage, self-confidence can be strengthened when children have to take risks within a game. All within a framework where the risk can be adapted to the skill level of the children. And really, it has no serious consequences if you fail. So you can try something and perceive yourself efficacy. Then you have dexterity games and games with time pressure that call for the ability to perform while enduring excitement. Also something very important. I have only 5 minutes, I have to leave the office now, but I should complete this email. If you're totally blocked, yeah, the 5 minutes will done, you will not write the email. But if you can endure the tension, you will perform then as well. Or I'm standing here and performing under tension instead of running out of the room. But I have to learn that at some point, and games are really great for this. And many games also train children's empathy and persuasive power when it comes to reading others' emotions in games or bluff the others into an opportune direction. And of course, games are so much on communication. So a great situation to train speech, to train communication, to form proper sentences, to understand others. So these are all aspects that I can't go into now, but they are all in the games. Instead, I want to thank you for your patience, for your focus, for your endurance. And I hope this talk was tailored to your needs and brought you a lot of joy and excitement. So you will remember it for a long time, and you are now intrinsically motivated to discuss this topic now and afterwards with me and back at home with your colleagues, teachers, head teachers, policymakers, and other gatekeepers that are in charge to allow you to unlock the potentials of game-based learning. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Very nice talk. So there is time for two questions. Are there questions? All right.
Thanks a lot for your nice presentation. It was inspiring. And you know, you gave some examples on maths concepts, mm-hmm. you know. And I believe that mathematics teachers especially focus on games, because if children play games, they focus on the process, not the result. Mm-hmm. And also, if they can adopt a behavior for solving problems, because problems are not just in the maths classes, but in life. So if they find a way of dealing with the problems in a unstressful way, they will get a lifelong skill. That's very important. So they should see the problems, even the maths problems, as puzzles and fun.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Totally agree. But there was no question, right? Totally agree, yeah.
I liked your way of presenting it way. That's why I wanted to share my ideas.
Okay, here's one last question.
Thanks, very inspiring. I just want to ask you if you will offer us an email for contact or getting an return for questions or any further things.
My email was on the program for today. So
all right, then I missed
that. Already you can contact me there.
That.
But we also we were talking about how to provide some information afterwards.
Right, thanks.
You can go on the website and on the newsletter. You will receive some information after the fair.
Okay.
But thanks. I cannot tell whether this will be in 1 or 2 weeks. Give me some time.
All right, so we need to stay with the schedule and we have 4 more minutes for the next talk. So yeah, let's thank the speaker once again.